Okay, thank you very much. I will talk a bit about experimental gravitation and the importance of time and clocks. This is my abstract and this is the outline of my talk. So first I give a short outline about the experimental status of gravity and then I turn to clocks and what one can do with clocks and then I describe the formalism of time within general relativity, describe some applications of clocks, practical applications in positioning and in geodesy, and then I will highlight a particular effect and then I also go to the Galileo satellites and give a outlook. So standard physics, as we know it, is mainly based on the Einstein equivalence principle, the university of free fall of the gravitational redshift and local Lorentz invariance. And from this principle, you can derive first the structure of the equations of motion for point particles of the Maxwell field, of the Dirac spinners and so on. And you also can draw serious conclusions on the structure of the field equations of the gravity, and it's known that gravity tells how matter moves, and the matter creates a gravitational field. So the all aspects of this Einstein equivalence principle is very well tested and confirmed. So here are all the tests confirming special relativity, independence of the velocity of light from the velocity of the source. There are very nice astrophysical observations analyzed with respect to this principle. Then the universality of the velocity of light, the isotropy now has reached an accuracy of 10 to minus 18 with optical resonators and all the other effects, including the used Drever experiments. The university of free fall, the weak equivalence principle, also is very well tested with the neutral bulk matter. There's one experiment with charged particles, also experiments with particles with a spin, and we are waiting for having a test with antimatter. And the best test until now was in the Edelberger group in University of Washington, restricting the Edelweiss parameter to 10 to minus 13. The microscope mission aims to reach a value better than 10 to minus 15, and the launch will be next year in April, and so we are really hoping that everything works well, and we had nice talks about that in the parallel session. And also new quantum tests using atom interferometry are designed to test the equivalence principle on the quantum level, as explained in this session of Guglielmo Tino. And now clocks show the same behavior in gravitational fields independent of what kind of clocks we have. It can be based on the electronic atomic structure or on hyperfine levels, molecular clocks, optical resonators, nuclear transitions, and again, people are working on doing spectroscopy with anti-hydrogen. So the foundations of our physics as we know it, and in particular of general relativity, is based on this Einstein equivalence principle. From that we can deduce that gravity is a metric theory, and from all these metric theories you can derive effects. These standard solar system effects, perihelion shift, gravitational redshift, deflection of light, time delay, then the Turing effect and the shift effect, and Francis will give the next talk about that, and also the physics in the strong gravitational fields and gravitational waves. And if the effects have a certain value, then we end up with a general relativity. The first thing, if one really wants to test whether general relativity is at the basis of our geometric understanding, we have to test whether the Newton potential in the weak field approximation is really the gravitational potential. This also has been tested very well in the framework of a Yukawa modification, and here you see the experimental status for short-range limits, and you know that in higher dimensional string theory predict deviations from the standard Newton potential here. And also for long range deviations, there have been tests designed, and the best tests come from the ephemerides observations, the ephemeride analysis. There are further issues which can be raised here, so whether it might be that the local Lorentz invariance, or that the local rotation invariance is broken for the Newton potential. So it might be that there are some cosmological given field Cij which breaks the rotation invariance. This has been described in the framework by Kosteletsky, and there also have been data analysis for testing this, and this is the result. So until now, everything confirms general relativity. There is no single experiment which contradicts any prediction and foundation of general relativity. There's one. It is very difficult to present an axiomatic or an operational approach to the Einstein field equations. This is not existing until now. One usually uses the PPN formalism to parameterize deviations from a standard general relativity, but then it is not included, for example, models having Finsdorf spacetimes as a basic geometric framework, and this has to be analyzed separately. Then we have the constancy of constants, and there's also a particular session on that by Victor Flambaum. One also has to look whether the third Newton axiom, actio equals reactio, or the question of active and passive mass or active and passive charges is fulfilled. And also it's a question whether the fundamental equations of motion are really of second order. If we start with a fourth order equation, then the geometrical setting might be a completely different one. Okay. And if one has now the formalism of general relativity, then can test all the predictions of general relativity, like, for example, the light effects, which are here in this parallel sessions. You find in this parallel sessions all the orbital effects of bodies in the solar system or in the gravitational field of black holes, and these are highlighted in these parallel sessions. So now I come to clocks. One basic ingredient of the characterization of measurements is the accuracy and the precision and stability. So what if you very nicely reach the predicted number in a measurement, then you have a very accurate measurement, and this also precise in a For temporal measurements, you are talking about stability. And if the measurement is not as well, then it is still accurate, but not precise or not stable. And what you need in gravity is mainly the stability or the precision of measurements for clocks. It is mainly the stability, and that is what we are talking about now. Nowadays, clocks have an incredible performance, and they are so good that they can see the gravitational redshift with a height difference of 1 centimeter. The accuracy today is of the order of 5 times 10 to minus minus 18, and the stability reaches 10 to minus 18. And it has also been shown from colleagues from the PTB that the clock comparison along thousands of kilometers does not disturb the stability of clocks. The stability of clock comparison with the optical fibers has the order of 10 to minus 19. For links to space, the stability is not as high, but it is improving. This is the measurement people have been carried through here. This is the range of optical clocks, and this is the stability measurement of the fiber link. What you can do with clocks, you will see all these gravitational effects here. So you have the Doppler effects, the Sagnac effect, first and second order gravitational redshift, gravitational time delay, and the gravitomagnetic clock effect. And most of them are negligible on Earth. Some have to be taken into account by, for example, defining the international atomic time. Most have to be taken into account if you want to have high precision time comparison with satellites. clocks are the basic quantity or the basic instruments in establishing the fundamental system of physical units. So if we start with the second, then we can, and this is the idea now, or one of the ideas to base all the physical units on the definition of time. So if one has the second, then one can define the meter through defining the velocity of light. One can define the kilogram then through the definition of the Planck constant. The ampere can be defined through a force comparison, and the Boltzmann constant is just is needed in order to define the Kelvin. So everything can be based on the definition of the second. The other question is the practicability of this way to define physical units. This is a different question. But the prerequisite for all this is that standard physics is valid. So if the clocks behave differently in gravitational fields, then everything breaks together, and we have to make another scheme. One also can define the time on the rotation of pulsars. They have a very good long-term stability. And clocks are most important in testing the foundations of special and general relativity. So all the tests of a special relativity can be described as clock comparison tests. And two of the tests the University of the Gravitational Redshift and local Lorentz invariants also are clock comparison tests here. For practical applications, clocks are the basic instruments for precise positioning, for an upcoming clock geodesy, and of course for the International Atomic Time. So, how we describe time within general relativity, we first determine the gravitational field by means of the Einstein field equation. The equation of motion for particles, objects, are given by the geodesic equation. If you have extended objects, things become much more complicated. And the clock, what a clock is showing is defined by this here. This is the relation for the proper time. And if one wants to make experiments and has to do clock comparison experiments, and this is described by this setting, if we have a stationary gravitational field, then if we have a Killing vector and the projection of the four velocity of the observer, which is aligned to the Killing vector onto the one form of the wave vector, then is a measured frequency. And then you can relate this to the metrical properties of space-time, and in the vicinity of the black hole horizon, this may reach infinity. This has been first confirmed by Pound and Rebka in 1960 with an accuracy of 1%. And the best test of this until now is the GPA experiment with a confirmation of the gravitational redshift of the order 10 to minus 4. These are Vesseau and Levine, and they tested the first order effect here, which is, so to say, which can be rephrased in that the relative frequency difference is given by the difference of the Newton potential. And if one adds here some additional term alpha, then what they found is that alpha has to be smaller than 10 to the minus 4. This is the experiment. So you have a hydrogen maser on a rocket compared to a hydrogen maser on a clock, and the rocket was launched up to 16,000 kilometers. The state of the art now is that 4 years ago, we had an accuracy, a precision of the clocks of 10 to minus 17, and then it has been shown in the laboratory that they have seen the gravitational redshift in a height difference of 30 centimeters. Now we have 10 to minus 18, and now this means that we have the redshift within one centimeter, and if you want to see the continental drift, then you can see this in the Doppler effect. If one want to make really the description of a clock comparison, then we want to have clock comparison between two satellites, or between the Earth and satellites, or between two positions on Earth. And if one, this is of course a complicated theoretical question for a simple, for a very simple case, we can, for example, have a clock on a circular orbit in a Schwarzschild space-time, and here we also have always the same time, and clock comparison is in a radial direction, and if you calculate this, then this is the exact timing formula. This, of course, has to be generalized to arbitrary orbits and arbitrary links, and to second Poussinian order, this has been solved by Linné and Tessandier a few years ago, and by other following papers. And the question is here, in principle, the following, that you have a clock moving around a gravitating body, and here you have an observer, and this then is, the clock is moving along the geodesics of in the space-time, and the light ray also moving along the geodesics, and then is this here question, if you here have ticks, what is the ticks you receive here at the observer? And of course, the observer can be on the surface of the gravitating body, and then you have the problem of here links between Earth and satellites. And this is here what I just described, and the question is the same if you want to have a good formula for pulsar timing. And what one needs is to find the light ray, the behavior of the light ray between the starting point given by elliptic functions or more general functions and the coordinates of the observer, which can be also different or even moving. And so this is the general question, and we are working on that. What is also something that can be done in the future is to do clock gradiometry. So if clocks can see the gravitational field within one centimeter height, then it makes sense to have a swarm of satellites, each equipped with a clock, and then to try to measure the gravitational field with this kind of clock. So one has to look for a time analog of the geodesic deviation formula. And the practical applications for clocks are positioning, and there's a very nice living review of Neil Ashby, where he explained all the connections to general relativity. And for geodesy, this is an upcoming field. Geodesists want to use clocks, high precision clocks for geodesy, and at the moment they are building up a fiber network in Europe, and one part of the network here is within Germany, and the link to Paris, and then you have a loop here and another leg here, and all this has to be described in a theoretical appropriate way. And what the people predicted, if you compare the clock in Braunschweig with a clock at Zürich, and this is then the shifts in the clocks calculated with this, translated to the Newton potential difference, and this is what you expect. So what you can do, you can have clocks with a long distance connections with optical fibers, and with this you can see the change of the height within a centimeter, so you can make very precise height measurements, and therefore geodetic, you can get very precise geodetic information also on a very short time scale. This is a big advantage to have here an instrument at hand by which you can obtain very fast your information. The general question is that you have here a network where everywhere there is a clock, and you have fibers here, and then the question is how to describe this in a general relativistic way. Of course, we know how to describe two clocks, but the question is what is the best way to extract appropriate geodetic information from this constellation here. And a first paper on this has been published by Stefan Schiller. And the question is how we can deal with stability questions, or if the fibers move a bit according to tectonic changes also. And this is the question how to eliminate this unwanted effects. And this may also be extended to a quantum networks, as it has been described by Koma and co-workers in Nature last year. And the question is how to do a nice leveling of the Earth. What is a big problem to a day is that there is no well-defined grid. The errors are more than 1 meter, and by using precise clocks and connections with satellites, it's a hope that in the near future one can get a worldwide defined grid within 10 centimeters of accuracy. Now I come to a particular effect in the last 10 minutes. So if we start with a Kerr solution of the Einstein-Field equation, you know all that, I have not to go into details. Then the gravitomagnetic field, highlighted here in this picture, then leads to various effects. First, it leads to a precession of the orbital plane of a point particle orbiting on a geodesic around this of this gravitating body. This has been seen in the Selargos experiment by Cifolini. This gravitomagnetic field also acts on rotating extended objects, spinning objects. And this will be the topic of Francis' talk now. And you can also try to measure this with atomic interferometry. There were proposals on that. You can also have effects on the quantum spin. This is different from the classical spin. So further fields maybe interact with a quantum spin. And then, and this is what I want to try to explain now in a short time, is to look for the gravitomagnetic clock effect. So also clocks will be influenced by the rotation parameter of clocks of the gravitating body. So we start with a geodesic equation. We have four constants of motion: the energy, the angular momentum, the normalization condition, and of course the Cantor constant. And the geodesic equation is equivalent to the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. We can make a separation ansatz. Find equations for r and theta with the separation constant k. We have also to introduce the mean time to obtain the final separation of these two equations, and then we obtain this differential equation, separated differential equations. Here we have a differential equation for the radial coordinate. For the polar coordinate theta, these are separated equations, and if you have the solution for that, then we can calculate the phi angle and the coordinate time. Here are the definitions. And this can be also extended to the whole class of Plebansky-Demjanski black hole space-time, so for that we have the full analytic solution. If you have bound orbits, then we have two periods in the radial direction and periods in the polar direction, and they are given by these quantities here, and the range of motion is given in this coordinate diagram, and then you have somehow like a deformed Lissajou figure in this gray shaded areas. We can define here exactly the secular time increase or the secular azimuthal angle increase. And from that and the definition of this period, we can define the radial radial frequency, the polar frequency, and the azimuth angle frequency. And if we want to define the Preston shift, it is just the difference between the radial frequency and the azimuthal frequency, and then the Turing effect is the difference between the polar angle frequency and the azimuthal angle frequency. And this also can be described in general space times. We can add or we can calculate the coordinate time for a revolution around 2p. We do need that. And also we can define a fundamental frequency for the proper time in the same way as we defined here. The y's here, we can do the same for the proper time, a complete analytic expression, and we can also calculate it for the full revolution of 2p 2 pi, and this is the solution. Now, if you have the proper time for the propagation of a particle in one direction and also in the opposite direction, then we see that there's a time difference of the clocks, and this time difference is given by this quantity. J is the angular parameter of the rotating black hole, and M is the mass of the black hole. And this has been first observed by Cohen and Mechoun in 93. And if you take this for satellites orbiting the Earth, then you have a time difference of 10 to minus 7 seconds per revolution, and this is clearly within the accuracy of clocks. And they also generalized it to eccentric orbits, inclined eccentric orbits, you see it here. But this also is not the real practical case, because if they are moving on the same orbit, they will crash. So we want to generalize this for arbitrary orbits, and this is what we did here. So we defined a new observable. So the gravitomagnetic clock, the gravitomagnetic time difference for two clocks orbiting along two different orbits in opposite direction along the around the gravitating black the Kerr black hole is given by this here, where this is the S defined here. And alpha is an additional constant, which is designed so that all the gravitoelectric effects vanish, and this can be defined as follow. We can calculate the alpha from the orbital data. We compute the energies and then determine the quantities by setting J equals zero, and then calculate and from that we can calculate again the proper time, and the alpha then is determined so that this gravitomagnetic time difference for J equals zero has to vanish. This defines the alpha. This is now given here. This is the determining formula. This is shown here, and with this alpha we now can go into this formula, and then this is the observable which only vanishes if the rotation parameter of the Kerr black hole is also vanishing. It has the correct non-relativistic limit or weak field limit, and if you apply this to two types of satellites, namely to the Galileo satellite with this orbital parameter, some height of 30,000 kilometer, inclination of 56 degree, with a compass, with a Chinese compass satellite which has an inclination of almost 0 degree, then we calculate an alpha being almost 0.5, and with this we calculate the gravitomagnetic clock effect to be almost 10 to minus 7 seconds, as also has been calculated by Mechoun in this idealized setting. This, of course, is an idealized calculation. For the real experiment in space, you, of course, have to take into account all the mass multiple moments of the Earth and so on. And it's also clear that the state of the satellites has to be known very precisely. The distance of the satellite to the center of the Earth has to be known within 3 centimeters, but this is no problem for these satellites. Experts tell that it is possible to locate the satellites within 1 centimeter precision. This kind of analysis can also be applied to a pulsar pair timing if you have two pulsars orbiting a black hole. So maybe this also has some application there. Okay, and then at the end, I will just tell that you certainly know that there are these Galileo satellites 5 and 6, which are brought in the wrong orbit. They have a comparably high ellipticity, which is not good for repositioning because they need a constant constant radius, but this is good for signs. And so the orbital parameters are here's the semi-major axis eccentricity. The original eccentricity was 0.23. Now they raised the perigeum, and now it's a 0.7. The inclination is a 50 degrees, and the clocks have a lap stability of 10 to minus 15. And with this numbers, it should be a good thing to use this Galileo satellites for a new test of the gravitational redshift. And people in meantime found out that the stability of the clocks in space is different from the clocks when they specified this on Earth. But we are trying to get more data and look whether it is possible to find a better test of the gravitational redshift. Okay, so I come to the end. So clocks are very important in the physics, in particular in the gravity. So it's important for positioning new ways to do geodesy, and they are also basic for all the tests of general relativity. And of course, there are many mission proposals with using clocks for testing special and general relativity. What is to be done in the future is to do analysis of clock networks, including clocks in space, to clock radiometry, and to push forward the theoretical description of timing, and of course also to push the experimental developments. Okay, with this I finish, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for a very interesting talk. We have time for a few questions. Ah, yes.
Oh, okay. Thank you. My question was just that you said you had got the Carter invariant limited on the equator. But it could be at any thing. Is it your choice to limit at the equator?
What?
The Carter invariant.
This is just a definition of the Carter constant. There are many ways to define it. Some are appropriate for these problems, others are appropriate for other problems, but they are just differed by a constant.
I see. You're limiting it.
Yeah. This is no limitation to anything. This is just a convention.
You mentioned this gravitomagnetic clock effect that they can be measured by Galileo satellites. And what's the problem with GPS satellites in this case?
Yeah, I showed you this is here. Yeah. Yeah, you have we just defined this observable here and calculated this quantity for these two types of satellites. What you need is the best thing if they counter propagate along around the Earth, but it's also okay if they co-move but have a different inclination. So if they have a different inclination, then the experience of the gravitomagnetic field is different, and this is what we want to see.
Time for one more question. Well, in that case, let me thank Klaus one more time.